Yes, we have now around 10 people. We'll wait another 2-3 minutes time. Then we can start. Please go back to this last week lesson, the last two pages. That is the practice questions. I wanted to discuss this the last week. We didn't have time. Today we'll start from that point. Practice question. Here people are coming. You can go through these practice questions. That is the last two pages of the first lesson, last week lesson. You have the note with you? Well, I can give you the access to that one. Wait a minute. That is the one. Yes, this is the one. Okay. Yeah, first lecture, week one. That is the practice questions. Classify the following statements. Now we have to go further up. Right, practice question. We'll spend about 10 minutes. Please go through and write the very short answers. Very short answers. 15 minutes for this one. Now it's about 10:30, let's say. 10:30, we'll start 10:45. Please go through and mark the questions, answer the question, because in the normal class I give you all the half an hour. But anyway, it's okay. Since you have already got this question paper, we'll spend only 15 minutes to answer this question. If someone has already answered, no problem. Keep it the very short answers, not the details. Brief answers. In short, what is the fundamental problem dealt with in economics? When you say, if you say scarcity or scarcity of resources in relation to human wants, that is okay. If you can't hear me, please tell me. Please tell me. Now I have already started. Today you all are lucky because today is a raining day. It's a cats and dog. Raining, we all are a bit unlucky. We have to come to this institution. You can lying on the bed and chat with the friends and the mothers and fathers. You can just listen to me. Anyway, right. We'll start now. At 15 minutes time, we'll start the practice question. After that, lesson number two. Lesson number two, demand, supply and the market. Right? Let's go through. I'll give you 15 minutes to try this question. There are about how many questions? 2, 3, 4, 5. Yes, question number five. Five questions, yes. Then 10:45, we'll discuss the paper. Then around 11 o'clock or 11:15, we'll discuss lesson number two. Just write down the answers. I want you to have a separate files for the lessons, answers to these practice questions. You have to answer and then put that in the same file. And probably I might give you around 15 of this time of this lessons, 15 lessons, along with the answer the practice questions. So you have to maintain a good file actually, though, but otherwise it will be a problem. Now, while we are discussing, if you have any clarifications or questions, please ask me. The you on your mic and the ask the question, number one. Number two, when I ask questions about the some of these clarification, please answer one of these. You on the mic and answer. Right, we'll start. The question number one, give brief answers to the following questions. In short, what is the fundamental problem dealt with in economics? What is it? Can one of you answer me? Hello, what is it? Fundamental
scarcity.
Good, very good. Like that, you can answer me. If you have any questions, you excuse me and ask the question, right? Good, very good. Thank you. But scarcity, you can say scarcity of resources in relation to human wants. Both are correct. The B, Sarat said, opportunity cost of attending the IABF class today is watching IPL match between Rajasthan Royals and Mumbai Kings. Kumar said, my opportunity cost is the sum of tuition fees, bus fares, food, and some other miscellaneous items. Who is right? Explain. First, let's discuss what is opportunity cost. Opportunity cost is cost of best, foregone alternative. Now, who is right? Sarat or Kumar? Yes? Sarat or Kumar? Who is talking about the foregone cost? Yes? Sarat. Sarat is telling my opportunity cost is watching IPL match. He had to sacrifice. He cannot attend. He can watch this match. The other Kumar said, my opportunity cost is sum of tuition fees, bus fares, food. These are direct costs. They are not opportunity costs. They are not foregone costs. Do you understand the difference? So Sarat is correct. Foregone, you sacrifice something. That is that. Number three, evaluate this statement. Saudi Arabia can pump all the oil that it needs. Therefore, consumption of oil is free in Saudi Arabia. This is a bit tricky question, not tricky. It's very easy. Saudi Arabia can pump all the oil that it needs because Saudi Arabia is the world, the highest and largest oil producer in the OPEC country. And at the same time, their oil extraction cost is very low because the oil deposits is very close to the earth. Then the extraction is very easy. Not that deep, you have need not to go to that deep, right? So the, what is the answer? Consumption of oil is free in Saudi Arabia. Tell me, one of you, what do you think? It doesn't matter, maybe wrong. Tell me, yes? True or false? Yes? All the oil that it needs, therefore consumption of oil is free in Saudi Arabia. What is the answer? Tell me, one of you, doesn't matter. Talk. One of these girls? Yes? Where are you? Correct? Or wrong? Right or wrong? It's wrong. Why is that? Good. Why is that? Yes? Why is that? You are right. Why is that?
Because Saudi Arabia can't pump all the oil needs in the world, I think.
Okay. Can't pump all the oils. Yes. That is... Yeah. Can you please speak so a little louder, my friend? Yes.
Yeah, Saudi Arabia can't pump all the oils that we need. So I think it's not correct.
It's not correct. Okay. That is the argument, no? It is like this. The opportunity cost, related to opportunity cost. Why is that? Even though they have the oil, so the if you consume all the oils within the country domestically, you forego something. What do you forego? your export earnings. You can sell that to the world, rest of the world, and earn dollars. Your foreign exchange, that will enter your foreign reserves. So you forego the reserves. Therefore, our statement is wrong. Because when you consume, you forego reserves. You forego foreign exchange earnings. And that therefore, it is statement is wrong. So the, everything has an opportunity cost. Last week we said that is the fundamental, the most important concept in economics. Everything, every action of human beings has an opportunity cost. You are studying. Now you spent around 10,000, 15,000 per subject. So there is an opportunity cost of this money if you don't study properly. Your parents can, it's not your money, it's a parent's money. That's the opportunity cost. When you don't study, the parents could spend this money to finance your the sisters or the brothers' tuition fees if you don't study. So opportunity cost is there. So think about that. Everything has an opportunity cost. So statement is wrong because Saudi Arabia, when they consume domestically, you have to forego the export earnings. There is the opportunity cost, therefore statement is wrong. B, the oil has dropped, price of oil. Oil price has dropped to historically low level to around $20 per barrel as a result of COVID-19. What are the possible reasons? Now, this is an open question. Now, in the paper, you get some open question. You can think and write. You're directly not related to this, the demand-supply diagrams or the balance of payment. Think and write. What is the answer? What do you think? Why? What are the reasons the oil price dropped from $80 per barrel to around $20 per barrel? I'm not quite sure about the current price. The $20, yes. Why is that? COVID. Why is that? What is the reason? Yes? Lockdown.
Because demand. Sorry? Because demand of the oil.
Demand.
Demand reduced because of the COVID-19.
Yeah.
The whole countries are under the lockdown. No.
Right. Exactly.
So there is no transportation facilities.
Exactly. You are right. Yes. You are the
huge, and factories also shut down.
Right. Huge drop in the demand.
Demands in oil.
Demand went down because of the lockdown. No activities, economic activities. So in the economy, huge drop in. Factories were closed. Car factories were closed. No transportation, no tourist arrival. All the planes were grounded. All the airlines grounded their planes. Huge drop in demand for oil. Price dropped. Price dropped. Now it is gradually start rising. COVID-19, right? So these are the reasons. Economic scarcity, party. Economic scarcity exists only in socialist countries, because of the lack of incentives to produce. Do you agree? Explain briefly. This is a past paper question. As I can remember, only in socialist country. Is that correct? No, because the scarcity is everywhere, irrespective of the type of the economy, structure of the economy. Scarcity of resources is a common thing. It's a fact common to every economy. So therefore, statement is we don't agree. You can explain that the scarcity of resources is a common problem, common enemy in every economy. Why is what to produce a problem in every economy? What to produce? What goods and services to produce? What is the reason? What is the reason? Resources are scarce. Resources are scarce. To produce goods and services, we need resources, factors of production, raw materials. Therefore, scarcity. We don't have enough resources. Therefore, it is a problem. Society has to decide, should we produce tea, rubber, coconut, should we produce cars, should we produce TV sets, or like that, they have to decide allocation of resources. So it is a scarcity of resources. What is the difference between a good and a service? Good and a service. Last week I discussed good and service, there are various differences, tangible, intangible, you can say. Then another thing is a good is produced, already produced, service produced on demand. Last week I discussed when you go and see a doctor, consult a doctor, when you start consulting, when you go and see the doctor and start telling you the problem, then at that point, doctor starts examining you, prescribing drugs, That is the point. He's selling his service. He is selling his service on demand. Goods already produced. Then what is the service performed by a bank? That's a good question. Bank, commercial bank. Now the bank is doing intermediary function. Take down intermediary function. What is intermediary function? You link two parties. You link two parties. Who are these two parties? Those who are in excess of money. In excess of money, savers. Then those who are in need of money, investors, borrowers. So then bank get money from the savers, paying some margin interest. At the same time, bank give this loan, they give this money, lend this money to the investors at a higher interest rate, at a higher rate than the savings rate. So therefore, bank is doing an intermediary function. Combine these two. You have these investors, bank, then you have the they get savers to pay the savings rate, deposit rate, lending rate. Bank's profit is proportionate to lending and the deposit rate. Can between these two. Can you see me? Can you see the board? Hello?
No, we can't see.
You can see?
You no, never we can't.
Yeah, I didn't hear you. Can you see the board?
Now can.
Yes.
Yes, we can. Okay, right. So bank is doing, bank's profit is proportionate to the gap between interest lending rate and the deposit rate, difference between these two. Now what is happening in the interest rate? Interest rate whole structure is coming down. The deposit rates is coming down, FD rate. It was around 11%, 10%, 8%, now it is around 7%, right? So the lending rate is also coming down. So that is central bank, the monetary policy they change, central bank is moving towards the low interest rate regime to encourage investors because of the COVID problem. So the central bank bonds make the cost of funds low to the investors. Therefore, the interest rate is coming down. So the gap margins, banks' margins may or may not. Most probably, they might come down. Profits might come down because of their profit is the gap between these two rates. Right? Okay. What is the service performed by? Well, last one. What does not Sri Lanka produce space shuttles? Open question. Can anyone answer? We don't produce space shuttle. We produce tea, rubber, coconut, housemaids. Yes. Why don't we produce space shuttles? Yes. What is the reason? Economic reason? Can you answer? Ladies, girls, where are you? Tell me. Sorry?
Opportunity cost of space shuttles are huge.
Little louder, space shuttles. Yeah.
Opportunity cost of space shuttles.
Oh, exactly. You are right. Opportunity cost. What is opportunity cost of space shuttle? Tell me. What is opportunity cost? Yes. What is opportunity? Opportunity cost is the amount of goods and services that has to be cut down to produce a one space shuttle. Amounts of other goods and services that has to be cut down to produce one space shuttle. Normally, space shuttles cost around $500 million, right? It's a huge money. So, the Sri Lankan government issue sovereign bonds worth of $500 million to raise funds from the foreigners. Now, in this case, you have to cut down amount of other goods and services equivalent to that amount. So, therefore, opportunity cost is huge. Therefore, we don't produce. Good. Thank you. That is the answer to that one. Right. Number two. Now, these things you can quickly go through. Last week we discussed normative and the positive statement. Rate of inflation has fallen below 10% per annum. A fact. It's a fact. You can measure inflation. Therefore, we don't have any judgments of the prescriptions, value judgments. Therefore, it is positive. Because inflation has fallen, now second question, see, because inflation has fallen, the government should now expand its activities. That is a judgment part is there. No. One can argue, no, inflation has fallen, government should not increase the activity, let private sector increase the activity. Like that, different opinions. That case, second statement is the normative. First one, positive, is in normative. Right? The second one. Third one, people in the UK are happier than people in India. It is positive or normative? Happiness, positive or normative? Actually, we should first discuss the question number four. Per capita GDP is higher in the UK than in India. What do you think? It is a measure. The per capita GDP can be measured, some number. Number is there. So you can calculate. Definitely, India's per capita GDP is lower than the UK. It is positive. Now we go to the question number three. People in the UK are happier than people in India. That is
normative.
Yes, normative, because the happiness depends on various things, not only the money, not only the GDP. There are various other factors, judgments. Sometimes, Indian people are, even though they are poor, their income inequality is high. People are happier. Indian people are happier than they are contented people than the UK. No competition. Therefore, you can argue Indian people are higher than the UK people. Like that, judgment is there. Therefore, it is normative. Fifth one, economics is more interesting than business mathematics. Definitely, it is normative. Because for me, maybe it is correct. Economy is more interesting than business mathematics. Some of them can, I don't know, economics is boring. So, the business mathematics is more interesting than economics. Judgments. Is it normative? It's a normative statement, right? Then we'll go back to this question number the three. Micro versus macro. We see the economy through a microscope. See the economy through a telescope in the macro. Micro versus macro. Classify. In other words, in micro, we take one of the markets and analyze, discuss. One of the behavior of a consumer, behavior of the producer, behavior of one market. That is micro. Macro, unemployment, inflation, GDP, macro, right? Question number one, coconut production decreased due to severe drought in producing these sticks. MIOMA?
Micro.
Micro. Good. Unemployment rate is less than 5%. That is MA. Macro. Unemployment. Unemployment rate. Macro. Big things. Big picture. In Sri Lanka, unemployment rate is around 4%. Which country has the highest unemployment rate? I think last week we discussed, no? These days, most of the European countries, South African, American countries, not only now after COVID, post-COVID, post-pandemic era, almost all the countries in the world will have to face the high unemployment rate. Even Sri Lanka, now currently is 4 to 5%. We don't know. Some suggest it is around 6%, 7%. New Zealand has estimated it will go up to 20%. US. Around 20%. The US, I saw one of the estimates in the CNN. They say around 20 million people will be unemployed. 20 to 25 million people will be unemployed. 20 to 25 million is equivalent to Sri Lanka's more than the Sri Lanka's total population, right? So that is the huge unemployment in the short run. Once there are the adjustments, it will come back to normal level. But initially, huge recession. Recession has been predicted. Now, the Sri Lanka economy has been growing at the rate of 7% per annum. Of course, it is macro. Macro. The insurance industry is becoming more competitive. Insurance industry. The financial sector. There are lots of other industry. Commercial banking sector, insurance sector, primary dealers, the development banks, leasing companies, different industries. Now here, it is micro, more competitive. Other things, question number the four, I am not going to discuss. This is a theory. You can find all the answers, and at the same time we discuss. If you have any questions, please go through a textbook and what is opportunity cost? Cost of best foregone alternative. What is unemployment rate? percentage of people without jobs in the labor force, infection rate. Please, I want you to do the reference, little bit of reference, readings and read. Now, the last question, the question number five, a story. A Korean professor who was invited to deliver a lecture on a few lessons of financial sector consolidation in Korea. Financial sector, because the consolidation is in Korea, have a large number of small sector, the financial companies, finance companies or the other small banks, then consolidate. Government initiated to consolidation program, amalgamate, take over. There was one company, one small company is taken over by another big company. Like that, you reduce the size of this number of companies in the industry. So that is called consolidation. Even Sri Lanka, we tried long time ago for the finance companies, right? It was not that successful. Arrived Colombo Bandaranaike International Airport midnight from Seoul. At the end of his presentation, he said that he had visited Sri Lanka in the year 2000. This is maybe 2000, and pleased to see the changes being taken place in the city today. Some of his observations were BIA, Bandaranaike International Airport, has become a very busy airport. There were large numbers of passengers, both at the arrival and departure gates. All bank branches and BIA were crowded with customers. Number of money changers in the city has increased, money changers. There are large numbers of eating places in the city. The security checkpoints in the city have been abolished. Franchise shops of international food chains such as Pizza Hut, McDonald's, KFC, Domino, Bread Talk have opened their branches in the city. Several highways have been constructed and a few other are being constructed. Even in the midnight, a large number of vehicles and people are in the city. What of his observation indicate? Which of the following reasons, only one reason, most relevant explanation? Colombo is becoming a popular tourist destination. Most Sri Lankans now travel abroad. Increasing number of Sri Lankans could now afford buying their meals outside. There are lots of economic activities in Colombo and suburbs today. Banking business at the BIA is profitable. What is the most relevant one? A, B, C, D, E.
A. Colombo is becoming a popular tourist.
Becoming a popular tourist. A. Any other answers? Why only tourists? There are franchise shops.
D.
Sorry?
D.
What is your answer?
D.
B?
D, D.
E.
D, D. Yeah, yeah. D is the one. Economic activities. Economic activities. Transportation, construction, retail trading. These are economic activities. Electricity generation, money changing. Economic activities. Now, after war, now these economic activities were flourishing. That is, that's why the most relevant one is, others are correct. Motorist, A is correct. Travel abroad, A is correct. Departure gate is busy. Could now afford buying their meals outside? Yes. Here you can see lots of these franchise shops and the eating places are there. Then last one, banking business at the BIA is profitable. That is, lots of banks are there, but the thing is, it is not profitable generally, where the banks are maintaining their branches at the BIA facilitate the foreign exchange transaction to the incoming and outgoing tourists. They are not profitable, most of the banks, right? But they have to do that. They must do that, right? Right. So therefore, relevant answer is number D. What are economic activities that we can identify from his observation? Economic activities, now already we discussed, construction, tourism, retail trading, what else? Transportation. In the city, there are night also now, security services. These are the economic activities, formal economic activities, legal economic activities, right? Some countries you have illegal economic activities. Now Italy, lots of underground informal economic activities. They are not coming to the normal the official economy. Sometimes they are not counted to the GDP calculation, right? Informal sector, underground. Even Sri Lanka, most of the countries, you have this underground economic activity, drug trafficking. So then it is one. Then the prostitution, commission charging. These are illegal, informal economic. That money transaction is there, right? Then, but these are formal economic act. You can have a monetary value, measure this value. More economic activity mean more employment. Do you agree? What is the answer? Correct? True or false? Yes? One of you, please. Where are the girls? More economic activities mean more employment. True or false?
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Correct. Now the to generate more construction, more tourism, tour agents are there, tour operators will be there, travel guides will be there. These are more employment. Then retail trading, some shops, this Pizza Hut, KFC, the managers level, then the lower level, the services there, more employment, right? Now, little bit, another analysis also, this is, now when you say employment, you have labor employment, you employ people, employ men, then employment of capital, you employ computers, use only the capital goods, computers. Sometimes in the world, huge the international bookshops are there. They do this the online services. You can order. You can order tonight. You can order any very expensive book from US one of these bookshops. Day after tomorrow, the book will be delivered to you through DHL. Right? You pay make the payment through your the credit card. Most of the bookshops, only one or two, the huge, only two people, three people, but large number of terminals, computers are there. That is employment of capital, computers. So employment, labor employment definitely increases, right? Sometimes maybe capital employment also. Employment means employment of labor, employment of capital goods, both. Your answer is correct. Labor and the other employment. Explain briefly, right? Okay, now we will go to this, please. Ask these questions, write separate answers, think about that. This is a very simple question paper. Maintain separate file. Answer these. You have your answers with the handout. You maintain the file, right? Now we'll go back to this, next today's lesson. Yes. Demand, supply and the market. Here also I have the lesson. First we'll discuss. After that, at the end of this lesson, you have the, like in the first year, the practice questions. Next week we'll discuss the practice question first. They are easy actually. Practice questions number two. Now every lesson, at the end of the lesson, I will attach. Try to attach. Most of the lessons, this the practice questions, some calculations are there. Anyway, right? Yes. So this thing. Right. Now this is the last slide of this first lesson. Lesson number one. Yes, I have. We have this one. Yes. Yeah, this one. Right. Four sector model. What are the four sectors? Household, government, business sector, Now the four sectors: household sector, government sector, business sector, that is firms, and the foreign sector. Markets, labor market, financial market, goods market. Market forces, supply and demand. Then economic activities, the taxes, transfers, savings, consumption, import, export, economic activities, right? This is a real economy, very complicated, real economy, right? Last week we discussed within this market, the, for example, financial market, large number of different industries, commercial banking, insurance industry, like that, different the players are there, different small markets are there. Generally, it is called financial market. Now, this is the starting point, right? Now, we'll discuss, you have demand and supply. Demand for labor, supply of labor. Demand for goods, supply of goods. Demand for exports, supply of the exports, right? Like that, the now we'll discuss, what do you put down? Yes, right. Now the government. Now we have the government sector. How does the government allocate resources? Last week we discussed government allocate resources through the budget. Every year, November 6th, you have the budget. In the budget, they allocate for education, for health, transportation, then the electricity generation, education, allocate resources, government. That is centrally planned system. Budget has to be approved by the parliament. That means, but the parliamentary members are elected by us, by the people. That means government budget should be approved by the general public of this country. That is one of the requirements of the constitutions, Sri Lanka's constitution. That government budget. Sorry. Excuse me. Government allocate resources through the budget. Budget has to be approved by the people. If the budget is defeated at the parliament, that means general public does not apply the resource allocation plan, government has to be dissolved and they'll have to go for a new election, right? That is the rule. Then private sector allocate resources through the market mechanism. Market mechanism. What is market mechanism? Market mechanism is there are two forces in this market, demand force, supply force, demand side and the supply side. Interaction between demand and supply forces, the allocate resources. Good example is these days, there's huge demand for face masks, right? Now what do? Private sector, they see this. Ventilators, huge demand for that one. Folding beds, that's a huge demand. So private sector allocate their resources, they bring down, sometimes they import, sometimes they locally produce. They locally produce and do research with local universities and start producing these things, face masks. Now prices ranging from normally 60 rupees, 65 rupees, around what is N95. Very expensive face mask is around 500. It was around 800. Now it is around, yesterday I had a chance to check with one of these pharmacies in Colombo. It's around the 300 to 500 rupees between, right? Different, this. Usable, reusable. So that is, then private sector, when they see this demand market, demand is increasing, they allocate their resources. That is the market force. They allocate their resources to things. Now these days, billions of rupees are being invested by scientists. For what? To invent the vaccine for this COVID-19. COVID-19 is up. Not the scientists, they don't have, these are private companies. huge private company because it's a highly, highly profitable job. If you produce the vaccine within 6 months, they can make billions of dollars, right? That's what they are competing. So resource allocation is done through the market mechanism, market forces, market signal. Is the demand and supply, supply coming from these forces, right? Right. Now we are discussing this private sector, demand and supply, not the government. Government budget, we have separate lecture under macro, maybe end of this second or third month we'll discuss. But now we are going to discuss private sector, allocation of resources. Then first the market. Market is a set of arrangements by which buyers and sellers are in contact. Really, I think I want to go to this. No. This is my PowerPoint. Let me see. PowerPoint. I think I have the lesson also. No, I need the lesson. PowerPoint is with you, but we have to have the my note. Have you got the note? Lesson number two. Hello. Can you hear me?
Yes,
we can hear.
Have you got number two? Yes, you have got, no?
Yes, we do.
Oh, I see. But we have not uploaded here in the distinct the notice. No, please go through that notice. Not that much difference, but anyway, we'll use a PowerPoint presentation. Keep the both. Okay. Then the option, right? Market. What is a market? Not as much the detailed version is there, but you can go through. But same concepts are discussed here. A market is a set of arrangements by which buyers and sellers are in contact. Buyers are there, sellers are there. Sunday fair. Go to Sunday fair. You are the buyers. You represent demand side. Sellers are there. You in contact. But some markets you don't have this kind of arrangements. The transaction completed only using intermediaries. For example, share market, you can't see the buyer and the seller physically. They are not there. They are only share broker. Do everything for you. You phone your share broker. I want to buy 1,000 shares from the JKH. Don't yields. Then please make arrangements. Then he has information about who are the sellers. Then he do the things. That is a transaction. Demand and supply. Demand, there are suppliers like that. Okay. So the other market mainly through intermediaries. That's why I wanted to give some examples. Share market, stock market. They are online. E-commerce. You don't see the buyer and the seller. When you order, book through online. You don't see the buyer seller, but you can do the thing. Next one. Then you have two forces: quantity demanded and quantity supply. Quantity demanded. What are the factors that everything is there in the note also? The quantity demanded depends on of a good quantity demand for ice cream cones, quantity demand for rice, quantity demand for fish, quantity demand for vegetable. Key factor is the price of that good. Then prices of other goods, substitutes, complements. Maybe if you think about the quantity demanded of fish, you always think about if you don't have any restrictions eating meat, price of chicken, price of lamb, price of mutton. Then the complementary goods, right? Fish and chips, complementary, right? Then the consumer's income. If you don't have enough income, we will do the window shopping. Now at near the in front of this World Trade Center, there are very expensive cars. But there are Lamborghinis, maybe some very expensive cars. We don't know the prices, even we don't ask. But we sometimes go and say the watch this. What are the facilities available? Why is that? Because we don't have enough purchasing power. We don't have enough income. You do the window shopping, right? You know, income is very important. Buy the taste. likes and dislikes matters. Likes and dislikes also a very important factor that affect the quantity demanded of a good. Then expected future price, that is very important, expected future price of the good. Now these days there are restriction on the importation of cars. Government has issued a circular, the car importation, vehicle importation has been banned. So definitely the domestic market car prices are going up. Even second hand cars, imported cars, available cars, car sales, so that is it is increasing. Therefore people don't demand today, people will demand after 2-3 months time. So today's demand depends on not the current price, tomorrow's price. Demand quantity, demand depends on not the current price, expected price. If the expected price is high, you increase demand, current demand. If you think expected price will be lower, then you wait and see. You postpone your demand, you don't demand now. So therefore today's demand depends on tomorrow's price. Quantity demand, current demand depends on the expected future price of the good. Gold, you think gold price will go up next month, then ladies will not buy. So we'll say, okay, gold will be cheaper next month, 2 months time, so we'll wait, don't want to buy. So if he thinks the current price is very cheap, then they will demand the gold next month. They'll go to Wong's and the other gold shops and buy. Which country has highest gold consumption, per capita consumption in the world? Simple question. You can answer. Yeah. Which country highest per capita consumption of gold? Ladies, girls, which country in the world? Lots of gold. Bangles, then earrings. Which country has the highest consumption of gold?
India.
Very good. India, right? India. In our ladies per capita consumption, you can just count these numbers to maybe 6 bangles, 2 earrings, 2 sets of earrings, then the like that. Very simple. Now you can see in India, per capita consumption is huge. In the world, highest per capita consumption is the Indian ladies. They consume, they store their assets. It's storing assets. If you have more gold, so asset is one of the very important item in your asset portfolio, right? Gold. Even Sri Lanka asset portfolio, you can make money. You can convert that into cash. You go to the bank and pawn it, right? You can make money. But India is the highest per capita consumption, and you can see lots of the Indian films. May Adare, lots of films, lots of Hindi films. Gold is foreign, the ladies, right? You can see that is the gold is right. But the thing is, if you think about demand for gold, definitely today's demand depends on next month price of gold, expected future price. Right? Then another factor, number of consumers. Number of consumers is higher the number of consumers, higher the demand. Higher the demand. That is the thing. Now these days, the market for face masks. Everybody, that's a huge market. Think about that. In Sri Lanka, what is the population in Sri Lanka? Sri Lanka population? How many? How much? Tell me. Basics. Yeah, boys? Sri Lanka's population, how much? Yeah? Sorry? Yes? I can't hear you. Please speak louder.
22 million.
Sorry? How much?
22 million.
22 million. Good. 22 million. 22 million. Then how many households? How many households? Population 22 million, 21 point something, millions. Household, how do you calculate? What is household size? Average household size in Sri Lanka? Around, yes. Household size is around 4, let's say. If you divide this 20 million, let's say by 4, 5 million, 5 to 6 million households, right? Household size, 5 to 6 million households are there. In our household size is falling. Now, for example, your parents, family, my father's family, household size, 10 people, 11 people, then 7, 8, now it is now 80s, it came down to around 6, then 5, 3, 4, 2. Now on average, most of these urban families, average household size is around 2, sometimes 0, right? They don't want babies, right? So the zero, right? That is, now this world is moving toward that also. Household, average household size is also falling, right? So the markets are shrinking. Number of consumers may be falling in proportion to that, right? That is people going solo. People are living alone. Going solo is the pattern in the world. Now, most of the US cities, percentage of people living alone, going solo is very high. Some cities around 30%, 40% people living alone. They don't want this. Marriage is not a matter for them because they have everything. Security is there. Medical facilities are there, right? So they are not alone, right? But in Sri Lankan case, security is the main problem. So you can't go solo. But it is up to the people, up to the individual. If you decide, I want to be alone, I want to be myself. No, it is a individual decision, right? You can't say it is good or bad, right or wrong. It's an individual decision, right? It is outside this lesson. But anyway, consumers, number of consumers matters. The market demand, quantity demand depends on number of consumers. Right. Now we discuss all the factors. When you include all the factors to the demand, that is called demand functions. Now from this, we define another term that is called demand schedule. When other factors are held constant, that you call other factors mean other than the price. Price of other goods, income, taste, expected future price, number of consumers, they are all constant, they are not variable, fixed. Then what will happen? Quantity demand depends only on price. This is called demand schedule. Demand schedule. Then other factors, whatever other factors, they are fixed, constant. Demand schedule. So, second concept, demand function. Now the demand schedule. Third one is the demand curve. Demand curve is this one demand curve. When other factors are held constant, there is a negative relationship between price of the good and quantity demanded of that good. Along this demand curve, what about other factors? They are held constant. Income constant, prices of other good constant, taste constant, expected future price constant, everything constant. So this is the demand curve, right? Then quantity supplied. Now this in the note, I have discussed quantity demanded first. Then I have given the example, the Sara's demand schedule and demand curve. Now the ice cream, cones, ice cream, you can see that one. I have drawn the demand curve. This is a detailed discussion in there. Then the supply side, same thing, flow is there. But you have more discussion in the note. Similar to demand side, we can discuss supply. Quantity supply depends on what are the factors. The quantity supply depends on we'll have a break around 11:38. No, yeah, that's right. Anyway, it's supposed to be finished at 12:15. Okay, we'll continue. Right? Supply depends on price key. Quantity supplied of paddy depends on price of paddy. Prices of factors of production, wage rate, weedicide, insecticides, these are the maybe kerosene if you want, some electricity if they want, then factors of production. Government regulation, whether there is a subsidy or a tax, the government regulation, sometimes technology. For example, quantity supplied of paddy depends on technology also. What kind of technology? Men and machine, the combination technology, more men, less machines, more machines, less men can be used, this kind of technology. Then the expected future price, like in the demand side, expected future price, after that number of farmers, number of firms, that is called supply function is there. That is the whole, when you include all the variables that may affect the quantity supply, you can have, depending on other factors, in the case of paddy, we have not included weather. There is a key factor. It depends. Manufacturing good is not supply of manufacturing good is not affected by the weather, but agriculture crop definitely weather is a factor. It depends. You can include all the weather, but more these factors, most of the factors are included generally. You have to make some adjustments depending on the the good supply function. Similar to this demand side, we define then supply the schedule. When other factors are concerned, supply quantity supply depends on price. What happened to other factors? They are fixed. They are constant. They are there. They are constant. They are not variable. Then graphical representation of the supply schedule is called supply curve. Supply curve. Supply curve is generally upward slope. Now, if you go back to demand curve, there's a law of demand. Law of demand say there is a negative relationship between price and quantity demanded when other factors are held constant. And in the examination, if you ask what is law of demand, if you write there is a negative relationship between quantity demanded and the price, you get zero. You don't get any marks. What is the correct statement? There's a negative relationship between price and quantity demanded when other factors are held constant. Then you get full marks. Other short statement, you don't get marks, right? Similar to the supply side also, your supply curve, there's a positive relationship between quantity supplied and the quantity price and the quantity supplied when other factors are held constant. Prices of factors of production, technology, government regulations, then number of firms, these are held constant. Now we know briefly demand side and supply side. In the note you can see quantity supplied, then the equilibrium quantity supplied. Please read this. I have given some examples also. You can try that. Yes, supply of corns, ice cream corns, right? Then they demand supply together combined. Market equilibrium. Now we come to market equilibrium. Market equilibrium price. What is market equilibrium? Now demand side is downward sloping, supply side is upward sloping. Demand curve indicates people's willingness to buy the good at every price. Downward sloping. Higher the price, lower the demand. Lower the price, higher the demand. Supply curve, producers' willingness to supply. Supply the good. Higher the price, higher the willingness to supply. Higher the quantity supplied. Lower the price, lower willingness is there to supply the good, right? So therefore, then these two curves are there. You draw these curves, then at this point of intersection of demand and supply curve, P star. That is a intersection point, mathematically speaking, that is a point of intersection. But what is economics behind this? Economics behind this, P star and Q star. At P star, at this P star price, consumers are willing to buy Q star units of the good. That is the economics of that. What is the economics of supply side? At the P star, producers are willing to supply Q star amount of the good. So therefore, both parties are happy. Both parties are happy. That equilibrium is called, that is the equilibrium. The point where the willingness to supply is equal to willingness to demand. So that is that price is called equilibrium price. That quantity is called equilibrium quantity. Equilibrium price, equilibrium quantity. For example, if now you can discuss the deviation. Suppose the price is above the equilibrium price, P1. P1 is higher. What will happen? Then who is happy? When price is higher, suppliers are happy. They can sell their item at higher price than the P star. They are happy. Who are sad? Consumers are sad. So what will happen? At P1, producers are willing to supply more. Point B, indicated by point B. That is the supply. But the consumers are sad. Because price is higher, it is not P star, they cut down their demand. Then what will happen? there will be excess supply of the good. Supply is higher than supply is B, indicated by point B, this vertical distance, this point is B. Demand is dashed point is at pointed axis. Then the gap between these two is the excess supply. Excess supply. At price above the equilibrium price, there is excess supply. What is excess supply? Excess supply surplus or the shortage? Yes? Surplus the shortage. The good excess supply means surplus or the shortage. Tell me. Excess supply of the good is what? Surplus or the shortage? Hello? Hello? Can you hear? Hello? Hello? Can you hear? Surplus or the shortage? Tell me one of you. Hello? Can you hear me, please? Hello, can you hear me? Can you hear me? Please answer. Please answer. Can you hear
yes,
me?
Sir. Yes.
Okay.
Sir.
Right. Then the excess supply means surplus. Then the price below the equilibrium price, excess demand means shortage. Excess demand means shortage. You can see that is a shortage. Shortage of the good at P2, there is a shortage of the good in the market. Now, demand curve. When we draw the demand curve, we assume other factors are held constant. What are these other factors? Related goods, prices of related goods. Then you have the income of the consumers, taste, preference, they are held constant. Then what will happen? If you change one of these factors, what will happen? Demand curve. Demand curve shifts. Up or down, up or down. Demand curve shifts up or down, right? You can see increase in price of chicken will shift the demand curve for fish. Now this demand curve D is drawn for quantity demanded of fish and price of fish. Now along this demand curve, we assume price of chicken is constant. Now suppose chicken price increases, what will happen? Chicken is expensive, people increase the demand for fish. Now we have new demand curve shifts upward. D2, D1, D2, D1. That is the new demand curve. An increase in price of chicken will shift the demand curve for fish to the right. What will have the equilibrium price? Price increases. We start to earn a new price. Because now higher demand for the chicken, the price fish, because the chicken is expensive, people shift their consumption from the chicken to the fish. More demand, the price of fish increase. This happens. Then, three factors that will shift the demand curve for fish to the right. Exercise. These are the exercises. You can do that. Then, what is the impact of this? I have included this at the end of this lesson. We have the practice question. You can try that. Question shifting the demand curve and the supply curve. Yeah, we can discuss. Next week, we will discuss. Then the name three factor that will shift the demand curve for fish to the left. To the left. Demand curve. Right. Demand curve up and the right. Demand go down and the left. You can think if you change one of the other factors, definitely it will shift up or down. But direction depends on your shock disturbance. When the chicken is expensive, demand for fish increases. If the chicken is cheap, demand for fish decreases. When consumer income increases, demand for fish increases. When consumer income decreases, demand curve shifts down like that. Right? You have to indicate that number of consumers increases, fish increases. Suppose people decide because of the health reasons, you don't want to eat no meat, no chicken, no mutton, no only fish. Then with a huge increase in demand for fish. But people will start buying more and more fish. Well, it will give you triglycerides, the good cholesterol. So therefore, fish price increases, number of consumers increases. If number of consumers decreases, that's what. This happens during the tsunami period. What will happen? There is a huge demand for small fish. tsunami period. No demand for big fish. Why the reason? Because the people believe that most of these tsunami affected the family, they are the dead bodies float to this sea. Then these big fish ate these dead bodies. Therefore, their taste were different. So they don't want to eat the big fish. They ate only small fish. Now, then what happened? We talked to this, those days, we talked to this fish market, St. John's fish market. Then within 3 months time, again, there was a huge demand for big fish, right? These things people taste. When people taste changes, demand curve shifts up or down. When taste decreases for fish, big fish, then the demand decreases. When taste improves, these things happens like in long time ago, there was a rumor. One of the Middle East countries, there's the importation of non-halal. Because you know the Middle East countries, most of these people, majority, not almost all, eat halal food. So there was a rumor going on, the chicken imported from one of the countries, it's not halal. Then what will happen? The people didn't want to buy. All the ship load of chicken sent back to this country, right? So what is the reason? The taste decreases, demand for chicken decreases. So therefore, demand for ships down. Huge drop in demand. Now these things you can answer this question, right? Now this supply curve, similar to the demand side, supply curve also shift up or down, can go up or down, right? The decrease in the diesel price, one of the inputs. When the diesel is cheap, supply curve shifts down to the right. Decrease in the diesel prices will shift the supply curve of fish to the right. Demand curve is not affected because this is the diesel. This is one of the important inputs. Then when diesel is cheap, people will buy more diesel. So they store that, or they will stay in the sea a longer period. Then have a good fish catch. Then that is supply of fish increases, right? Like that, if the diesel price increases, it will go other way around, right? Okay. Name the three factors that will shift the supply of fish. Now these things, of course, the demand and supply, you may have studied this in your A levels, maybe in O levels, or when you are doing your SIMA or Chartered or sometime degree first year or second year. These are basics. That's why I want to discuss this bit fast, right? So name the three factors that will shift the supply. This is a homework question. And draw the diagram. Free market and price control. Now, up to now, we have discussed prices are determined only through the interaction between demand and supply. Demand can shift or down, supply can shift or down, but nobody intervene. No one say, okay, this price is very high, therefore we should control the price. No, it's purely determined by the demand and supply, right? For example, you can see this long time ago, before the lockdown, this price of this face the mask was around in Kadavata. It was around, I purchased for some reason, it was 15 rupees. Same thing. Now it is 6 rupees. It's a free market. Number of consumers increase, demand goes shift, price increase. Very simple. Now government doesn't intervene. Government doesn't say, oh, no, we want to control. Face mask is a very important item. Therefore, don't sell that at 60. Maximum price is 40 rupees. That is a price control. So free market, no intervention. No government intervention. No price control. But the government can intervene and control the price. There are reasons, because the poor people cannot afford this the face mask every day. If you don't do that, if you are supposed to wear every day a face mask, it's very cost. 6 rupees, it's not disposable. 6 rupees, 16 to 30 is 1,800, 2,000 rupees for a poor person. Poor family is very expensive. And at the same time, if you theoretically, each and every individual, suppose there are four people in the family, then 2,000 rupees into four, 8,000 rupees per family. For a poor family, it's quite expensive. So government can say, okay, no, this is very unfair. Don't sell face mask at this price. Our price is this. Control price. That is only 15 rupees, 20 rupees, 25 rupees. Like that, they can control. So therefore, free market sometimes, on some periods, government intervene and put the control price. That is, objective is to give some relief to the people. Government objective is very clear. Intention is good. Remember, now we are going to discuss, there are some bad side effects, negative side effects. Similarly, government can impose the floor price, see lower price, the minimum price. They can impose minimum, maximum price, it's called ceiling. Ceiling means you cannot go above this. Ceiling, maximum. Or government can impose a floor. This is a floor, you can't go below. Minimum price. Some markets, minimum price, for example, the Panadol. There's a maximum price, minimum price for this. A maximum price is there. Pharmaceutical product, very few pharmaceutical products, there are some maximum price, right? The metformin. Every day I'm using metformin because I'm on diabetics, right? My wife every day give the tablet, remind me to get the tablet. Otherwise, if I forget, problem. So therefore, the metformin is a very low control price is there, right? Then like that pressure tablets, the other cholesterol for this one, some people are using those tablets. There are some control prices. Minimum price, paddy price. Government has imposed 40 rupees per kilo. Purchase, when you purchase paddy, is minimum price for the you have to pay 40 rupees per kilo for the paddy farmers. That is the 50 rupees. Then that is the minimum price. Intention is very clear. Good. Give some relief either to the consumers, make consumers happy, or that is the ceiling price, or make producers happy, minimum price, floor price, make better farmers happy. Intention is very clear. What will happen? Then what will happen? Now, this is the minimum price. Minimum price is imposed above the market. Now, this dotted area line is the minimum price, PC. That is P star, the market equilibrium price. Market equilibrium price is very low. Government imposes a price above the market clearing price. That is the price. Therefore, it is the minimum price. Then what will happen? There will be excess supply of this good. Suppliers are happy. Supply will be higher than the demand. Therefore, there will be excess supply in the case of paddy. Excess supply of paddy in the market. That is a negative effect. People want to sell more and more paddy to the government. Then, but the demand is less. Suppliers, farmers want to sell. Private traders, they demand paddy, they demand less. Then there will be excess supply. So therefore, the marketing board or the paddy marketing board should buy this excess supply of paddy. AB, excess supply of paddy. So the accumulation of paddy in the market. That is the reason. So therefore, when you impose a minimum price, there will be excess supply of that good or service. Therefore, government has to intervene and clear that excess supply. Otherwise, farmers will be affected. Now you can see Tambul area, some farmers just dump their whole production of pumpkins. They can't sell, no demand, they supply. Paddy also, there are long queues. Farmers bring all their stuff to sell to the marketing. Paddy marketing board. Paddy marketing board say we don't have money to buy. Excess supply. They wait, waiting for 2-3 weeks, sometimes weeks time, they go back and sell the same stuff to the private trader at a lower price. That is a tragedy. That is the unfortunate thing for the farmers in this country when you impose the ceiling price, so the minimum price, the floor price. Similarly, maximum price is imposed below the maximum, the market clearing price, drugs, metformin, insulin, then pressure tablets, cholesterol tablets you can import because people cannot afford food prices. Price. Now, good example is 9 rupees. That is the best example. Government has imposed maximum price for rice, 9 rupees per kilo. But the thing is, you can't find rice at 9 rupees. Millers complain, your cost of production is very high. You can't sell rice at that price to the traders. So therefore, there's a black market, hoardings, scarcity of the good in the market. These are the things happening in the market, right? Ceiling and floor prices, you can read that. Read that, the ceiling price imposed above. Answer these questions. Then usually we are supposed to stop at 12:15 with a break. So therefore today we didn't have a break. Therefore I'll stop now at 12. Then next week we'll meet again. Please read this lesson. This is easy. I have given more examples. Detail notice there. You can easily understand. And try these the questions. Practice questions. Again, there are about 3 big questions. The mathematical questions also. Try those questions and come to the class next week at 10:30. We'll see you. If any question, clarification, please. You can chat with me. You can speak. When you own the mic, you can speak to me. Any comments about this? Am I too fast or is it all right? My speed is okay? Tell me. Hello? All gone? Hello? Can you hear me? Hello? 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 Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Is that all right? My speed. Do you understand this stuff? It's okay.
Yes, sir.
Sorry.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Good. Don't hesitate to ask question. You can say you are the that is the problem in this country. You think okay, the teacher, we should not ask a question from teacher. Teacher might get angry. No. This is we should change this practice, sir. I can't understand. I can't hear you. Please explain that again. This is how the developed countries the students behave. This is we can't understand anything. Just tell me. Then only you can this online practice sessions will be productive. Otherwise, I can't see you all. Don't hesitate to ask question anytime. Stop me. Disturb me, sir. Please explain that again. Cultivate that practice, not only from me, even the teachers, stop me. Otherwise, it's bad, actually. We think, okay, teacher knows everything. I don't know everything. I know just only I have prepared this. I get up in the 5 o'clock in the morning and I know. I think about the examples, discuss with you, actual practical examples using this COVID-19. Then you can remember these things. So it's a set lecture. But you have questions, please ask me. I don't get angry with you. I am quite enjoy that thing. Discuss. When you ask question, other people also benefited. That is the asking question. That is one of the objective of asking question. You can educate others also. Even you don't know the answer, ask question, right? No foolish questions. Any question can be asked. I expect you more questions from the next lesson, right? Okay, be prepared. Now, next week, we'll start from the practice questions. You have to draw the diagram. I can't draw the diagram. You work out. We'll discuss the basics. Then next week, we'll see you. Thank you very much. Thank you.